breaking news, politics, and policy on Up and Atta, but not surprisingly, that's not what the majority of Americans are talking about.
Our intrepid reporter, Siri Free, spends hours sifting through the landfill of American culture to bring you the top five trending topics on social media. Almost got through it all. Social media. Siri, what's trending?
Number five.
We begin our trending topics on a rather personal note for me anyway morning.
Are you trending?
Apparently, in some form, everyone knows the iPhone's often sassy robo-assistant Siri, who, by the way, I do bear no relation to whatsoever, putting that out there.
As Schmidt called her on last night's New Girl.
Yes.
I didn't watch it. I don't know.
Oh, crap. Pants robot or robot.
What?
Pocket robot.
Pocket robot. I like pants robot.
No. And if you haven't become fed up with the glitches, perhaps you utilize the app often and feel maybe you've gotten to know Siri very well.
I use her all the time.
But do you know Siri? Have you ever asked her what her political views are?
I have not.
I saw that on the Facebook. My Siri is broken right now, so I couldn't. I don't know.
I did it and I tested it.
I'm glad this is on the list.
When you ask that question, Andrew?
What question should I ask Siri?
Ask Siri, what are your political views?
Okay. Siri, what are your political views?
Here's some information.
It just brings up a Wikipedia page for ideology.
Really? What? Then it's changed.
No, they changed it.
Oh, they changed it after it got
busted.
Some publicity. It used to
what
bring
did
up
it used
the,
to say?
The Wikipedia page for Ron Paul.
It did. It did. And libertarians online rejoiced. Could this be because Ron Paul supports the tech industry on topics such as internet freedom? Well, we're not entirely sure, and if that were the case, Al Gore's Wikipedia would probably be our homepage. But apparently, someone at Apple really wants you to learn about Ron Paul, except for the fact that now they have changed it, which is such a bummer. I thought that was quite entertaining.
I like that.
Siri, tell me a joke.
Oh, geez.
What did one iPhone say to the other iPhone?
Gosh.
I used to know this one.
What?
She's not that funny.
Apparently.
It's your pocket robot.
Hence the reason I'm not related to her at all.
Right.
Number four.
Well, you've heard the saying, Jack of all trades, master of none, correct?
Jack has heard that a lot because it's his name.
Well, maybe we can give Martha Stewart credit for most of her homemaking pursuits. However, snapping pictures apparently isn't one of them.
Is Martha Stewart on Snapchat now?
Well, no. Oh, no, because Snapchat would not be out to the public. The domestic goddess is grossing people out online with disgusting food tweets.
Okay. I thought we were going in a completely
weird direction.
No. Have you seen any of these?
No.
Oh, it's so bad.
She usually cooks delicious, beautiful meals.
I'm sure.
How could her food be disgusting?
Well, it's the food that she eats that she wants to take a picture of. It's her pictures. In an attempt to join the stereotype women have earned online, Martha takes pictures of all the food that she eats, all the meals. For example, one tweet pictured what was supposedly an iceberg wedge salad with homemade Russian dressing.
Okay.
I'm thankful that she explained it because what it looks like is something she ingested, got food poisoning from, and then vomited right back out on her plate.
It's the filters.
You go to
Instagram, you start doing those filters. A delicious plate of food into something diseased.
Ben, I think the problem is she doesn't use filters. It's so bad. You got to check this out.
Poor lighting.
Well, now, we're not criticizing the food itself, the way it tastes, or even its presentation. It just seems that Martha has a knack for making it look well past its prime.
Maybe things aren't going so hot in the old Stewart household. She's got to eat, you know, three-day-old food.
It's pretty bad. Apparently, she did catch the hint that we were all less than impressed. And in response, she tweeted, "There seems to be some buzz about my food picks." Apparently, the onion soup was utterly delicious and the iceberg wedge salad divine.
No, you got to keep in mind, though, Martha Stewart.
I can't stand her.
For a time period, did live off of prison toilet hooch.
Excellent.
Her taste may have changed.
Gross.
And frankly, it's the 3 a.m. photos of her meal at White Castle that really disturbed me.
Chestnut.
Oh, it's so sad. Yes.
Number three.
This is a sweet story. San Francisco was beset by a wave of crime on Friday as a woman was taken hostage, tied to cable car tracks, a criminal calling himself the Riddler attempted to rob a bank vault, and a miscreant known as Penguin generally made a nuisance of himself in the downtown area.
This sounds awful. Crime-ridden.
But let not your heart be troubled, Ben. Each incident was staged. an attempt on a part of the Make-A-Wish Foundation to give 5-year-old Miles Scott, who is recovering from leukemia, a memorable day as Bat Kid.
And this was a Make-A-Wish.
Yes.
Wish.
Have you seen this?
It was I've seen
pictures,
the video.
Videos all over. It was so
The whole
sweet.
City got involved.
Yes.
The San Francisco Giants got involved. I believe the Chronicle, the newspaper in town, printed a special issue saying Bat Kid saves the day or something like that.
He is the hero that San Francisco deserves.
Right?
But not the one that it needs right now.
Oh, sweet kid.
That's adorable.
Bat Kid spent the day saving the city, fighting crime and triumphing over his foes while celebrating the real victory of overcoming cancer.
Did you see that not everybody is fun on this issue?
Wait, people have objections to cute kids doing cute stuff?
Yeah. Supervisor Eric Marr complained about the expense.
Is this a city supervisor?
And the intentions.
Oh, stop. Yeah. You know what? It's not just about this one kid. It gives us all hope and inspiration.
It's a great story. And Make-A-Wish Foundation is a wonderful organization. They do
Absolutely.
Great things. And for this guy to send this little tweet out going, you know, how many kids could have gotten coats for with the money that was spent
well,
on this?
How about this?
He's a small and petty man.
Here's another reason that cities need to watch the budget. Because if you spend less on the stuff that doesn't matter, you can do stuff like this that does matter.
That does matter. Exactly.
The city spent a whole lot of money on this.
State Representative Nick Zerwas, I believe, was a Make-A-Wish kid until they realize he's had seven wishes.
Taking advantage of the system.
Number two.
Well, there's nothing like a little drama to turn an otherwise peaceful day upside down.
Drama.
According to New York City writer and comedian Kyle Ayers, he was just hanging out on his Brooklyn rooftop when a couple arrived and began breaking up.
Oh.
So how did he respond?
Did
perhaps
record it
discreetly left. Well, maybe record it. Well, in a way, he did. No, he did what any of us wish we would have thought to do ourselves. He live tweeted their breakup.
Oh, wow.
With the hashtag rooftop breakup. So this is hilarious. You have to read this.
This was great.
Here's what he started to tweet. A couple's breaking up on my roof right now.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm just trying to enjoy the view. Now I will live tweet the breakup. The girl begins. First of all, our saga centers on girl wants to move in with guy.
Okay.
That's the problem here. She begins, I'm not looking for marriage. Just what's right below marriage.
Right below marriage.
The guy says,
whoa, careful on the next one.
I know. Your roommates are bleeping, how can I say this?
Effing a-holes.
Yeah, that too, okay.
Wow.
She retorts back, well, don't let me live with them then. Then the plot thickens as text from my coworker element is added to the mix.
Goodness.
A text alert apparently goes off, and the guy quickly says, it's a text from my coworker, a work text. She says, well, let me read it then, the girl demands. Oh. Give me the phone.
Oh. She says she wants to know what's going on. Oh. She wants to see if there's another. Is there another person in this relationship?
Well, he says, you don't need to see my phone. Trust me.
Oh, no.
Wrong answer. Oh, gosh. And finally, she retorts out, do you love me? And he's like, listen, I'm not into that sort of thing. I'm not into the labels. So she finally.
Likely story.
Yeah. So are we going to get pizza or what? And she finally wisens up and says, why don't you go get pizza with person from work who texts you?
Nice.
Exactly.
Number one.
And the number one trending topic this week is also the number one trending word of the year, at least according to Oxford Dictionary.
Yes.
Every year, Oxford Dictionaries names a word of the year, the word that is judged to reflect the ethos, mood, and preoccupations of that particular year. And this year's winner is selfie.
Now, Siri, you take a lot of selfies.
You do,
well,
Siri. You do.
You do.
Okay. You do.
There's a lot of selfies.
No, this isn't a complaint.
Yeah. If Ben was taking selfies all day, I would have problems with that. You're
Jack,
fine.
I want to make clear.
I do reflect my culture. In all fairness, though, you can see my selfies. There's some selfies. I look terrible. I wear no makeup. I'm very much open.
Yeah,
and very,
you're a real monster.
Jack and I come from a generation that we don't take selfies. What is it? Why does this generation seem to be obsessed with photos of
themselves?
You know, that's
a good question. I don't know why, but originally, selfie dates back to 2002 is when the word first appeared.
The early days of the selfie.
Ancient lore.
Archaeologists
it was an old Viking
uncovered
word.
The first selfie.
From
2002.
From the Middle English.
Oh, the shirt I'm wearing right now is older than
2002. Well, I was 12 at that time, so it was a long time ago. It was half my life ago. Of course, I'm not going to remember that so well. It used to be spelled with a Y at the end, but now it's an I-E.
Okay,
sure. Making it cuter, apparently less narcissistic.
How?
But okay. So nothing nefarious going on here. Just cuties being sweeties taking selfies.
Cuties being sweeties.
I am neither a cutie nor a sweetie. Therefore, I don't take selfies.
Did you eat powdered sugar for breakfast today?
I know. I'm a little bit wound up.
Cuties and selfies.
This is a fun show in the morning.
It's an age thing. I said this to Fox 9 yesterday. It's under 25. Under 30? Under 25? I don't know.
Under 25. I think it's mostly it's mostly teens and early 20s.
When you take a picture of yourself, regardless of where you are, the picture is going to be the same unless you try to get some background in it.
But my mom always said, taking pictures, you shouldn't take pictures on vacation of just scenery. You should have people in it.
Your mom is right. You got to have people. Other people.
The best photos I've ever taken.
But if nobody's around, then there's just me.
Here are the great pyramids. 90% of this picture is my face, but there's part of the pyramid in the background.
The best photo I ever took, and it was on a vacation. My parents took me out to see the Grand Canyon in Nevada. Mm-hmm. And my dad, thinking, I want to see how really high this is, had like a little bit of water left in his water bottle. And he goes, hey, watch this, to his wife. I'm going to pour this down and we're going to see how long it takes for the water to reach the bottom. Well, just as he's turning the bottle over and the water is spilling out onto the dam, a gust of wind blows it up back into his face. And I get with my camera, immediately shoot a shot of him laughing with his face wet. And then I immediately turn to my right and take a photo of my mom laughing, going,
brilliant.
You are such a goof, but this is why I married you. I got those two photos framed in one of those swinging.
You should submit online. They're posting photos that are just like ironic moments that you catch.
Well, it's that moment sums up my parents to a T, and so I was real proud to give them in one of those special swinging two-frame frames. Both of those photos side by side.
I will typically take pictures of Hug Nugget. If I take a selfie, she is in it, so I can show people that I'm not, in fact, a monster.
Siri, thank you so much. First, I want to apologize for our mustaches for subjecting these to you, but we are participating in Movember with the Minnesota Wild.
I understand. It's for a good cause. I'm putting aside my own needs and desires, and I'm just going with it.
Pardon me.
But also, thank you for letting us know what's going on online, no matter how confusing it ends up being. We have to know, because we can end up learning from it.
That's true. You're
Thanks welcome. Again, Siri.